My pranams to all Atma Jyotis, Divine Light of Self. Today we are starting the first talk on a series of talks called Atma Vichara or Self Inquiry. What is this self inquiry? What is this self-inquiry all about? There are two paths for self-realization. As Sri Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Loke asmin dvida nishta pura prokta mayanaga jnana yogena sankhyana karma yogena yogina. There are two paths for self-realization. Path of karma and path of jnana. There are some people who follow the path of karma, or many people, most of the people follow the path of karma. And there are some mature people who have reached a level of maturity. Those people are called Sankhyas. So they follow the path of Jnana. So these are the two paths. Now what is the difference between these two paths? Path of Karma involves action. Any kind of action. What are the different types of action we do? The physical action, the mental action, the intellectual action, and the verbal action. Kaya, Vak, Manasa, Buddhi. So anywhere the focus is on action for realization is called Karma Yoga. The action is the physical. What is the physical action? I'll do service. I'll do devotion service. I'll serve the humankind. I'll serve the living beings. So the focus is on doing. No, I'll do yogasana, the hatha yoga, which involves seven stages: yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, samadhi. So some stages. Or I'll do verbal action, I'll chant, japa, prayer, then singing glories of God, bhajans. This comes under verbal action. The mental action comes in the form of the meditation. I'll visualize the form of the divine. I'll contemplate. The visualization involves the whatever form of the deity or Lord we visualize in our heart, mind, and offer our respect. It's called mental action. So the physical action is called Nishkama Karma or service. It's called Karma Yoga. In general, all yogas are classified in Karma Yoga because they involve action. The physical action service is called Nishkama Karma, the selfless service. It also can be called as Hatha Yoga, where physical body is involved. It can be called Japa Yoga when verbal action is involved. It is called Bhakti Yoga when the devotional action is involved, which is emotional, the emotion of love is involved. And when the intellectual action is called, it is Jnana Yoga or Path of Knowledge. So thus we have a Karma Yoga, which is general terminology, a broad category, which involves action. The physical action is Nishkama Karma, service. Physical action is Hatha Yoga. Physical action is working on the body in the form of energy, Kriya Yoga. mental verbal action in terms of japa yoga, mental action in terms of bhakti yoga, devotional service, and intellectual action in terms of jnana yoga or study of scriptures and contemplation. So we have only these four: physical, mental, verbal and intellectual. This involves action, doing. And when action is involved, there is a path and a goal. What is the goal of these actions? Is chitta shuddhi or purification of subconscious impressions what you have. Some degree of calming of the mind, purification of the subconscious impressions acquired through many lifetimes. It's called chitta shuddhi. So the karma yoga in general, which consists of nishkama karma, japa yoga, bhakti yoga or dhyana yoga. Bhakti also includes dhyana also, meditation also. Or jnana yoga, which involves contemplation. So these lead to a purification of your subconscious impression, chitta shuddhi. Jnana yoga, all this karma yoga involves a path. Path means there is one who treads the path, who goes on the path. The path has a goal, path has a destination, and path has a journey. That's what yoga is about. Yoga is about achieving something through action. Of course, the achieving something is achieving the divine or infinite or supreme. And there's a journey involved. So as a person matures in life through this yoga, his mind, subconscious impression starts getting clear. Then he realizes, I need to transcend these four. What are these four? The physical, mental, verbal and intellectual actions. So I have to make it jump. Yoga is a step, but what you need is a jump. Why do you need a jump? Why we need a jump? Because what we are seeking is the infinite, which is all pervading reality. For example, if I ask you how many steps you have to take to reach space, how many steps you have to take? Which direction you will go? Up, down, left, right? Where will you go to reach space? There's no direction in space because all directions are space. So in yoga, you started with a path, which means you are seeking it, you are going in a direction. But there is no path because the all-pervading reality of consciousness is everywhere. The concept of path itself is one of our psychological impressions, vasanas. There is no path to the infinite because infinite is all pervading, everywhere it is there. So such a person who understands this, gets this maturity after all purification, becomes a mature person called Sankhya. Sankhya means, comes from the word Sankhya, which is number. Sankhya is number. Number is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Somebody who has evaluated 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and ruled them out is called Sankhya. He has ruled out everything. Now he has come to a conclusion. Number 1, 2, 3, 4 doesn't work. He is not there. Reality for the infinity, these numbers or paths are not there. Because wherever you step, there is a path. Wherever you step, there is the infinity. Wherever you step, walk, there is walk, there is space. Wherever you see, there is divine, there is supreme. That understanding comes to him. And such a person is called Sankhya Yoga. Sankhya. He has become mature now. So that person, he makes a jump now. Earlier, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Kriya Yoga, there is a goal to reach. Now he starts questioning, who am I? Where am I going? Who is this me seeking this? So such a person takes a jump called Atma Vichara or self-enquiry. The self-enquiry is not a path. Like Karma Yoga and Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Kriya Yoga or Japa Yoga, which involves a path, which involves steps. Atma Vichara is a pathless path. There is no path. Here only questioning of the self, who am I? Why you question yourself? If infinite is everywhere, if that all that is pervading is infinite, all that is pervading is supreme reality, there is no path. Still I have not got it. Why? There must be some correction required in my understanding. And the correction is required in my belief systems, which is blocking my vision of reality. My belief systems which are blocking my reality. So these belief systems have to be questioned. What is the wrong belief I have about the absolute reality? These belief systems have to be questioned. And wrong belief system is thrown out. First belief system was, there is a path to the reality itself is a belief system. Now that particular thing has overcome. There is no path to the space. There is a path in the space, but there is no path to the space. So that belief he has overcome now. Okay, now he is standing where he is. He doesn't know where to go. Because anywhere you move, go more, there is space. But still, I am not experiencing space. Okay? What is the belief system which is blocking my vision of that infinity? That belief system has to be questioned. And I have to drop those belief systems. Now, what is a belief? Please tell me. What do you understand by word called belief? What exactly is a belief?
Somebody did it,
I believed it, I want to follow it. Right? So belief is actually taking something as true without verifying it. Taking something as true without verifying is called belief. So, is there a Himalaya? I have not seen it, but I believe it's there because many people say. Is there God? Definitely is there. How do you know? So many people say so. So I also believe. So what are the assumptions here? You have verified the assumptions. You have taken it for granted. You have taken as granted something as real without verifying is called believe. Understand? Now, is belief real? Is something called, you call belief is real? How do you know it's real?
It tends to change.
I cannot deny the existence of Mount Everest or Himalaya, even though I am not feeling.
So, that's what I'm saying. Here, you are not verified your assumption. No, no. See, here, the belief or reality is my own reality. My own experiential reality. Assumptions comes from somebody else saying and I accepting it as real. See, for example, the pain is your reality, it's not assumption. The happiness is your reality, is an assumption. Okay? But God is your assumption. So now what you are seeking? I don't want assumption, I want it as a reality. I don't want to go by second-hand experience, I want to have first-hand experience. Right? So when I am saying, I am seeking something, yoga or jnana, what am I seeing? I don't want assumptions, I want a reality. Is it clear? For example, there are so many Mahatmas, there is God. Why don't you keep quiet? Yeah, it is there. God is there. No. I want to realize it. It has to be my first hand experience. Not a second hand experience. Second hand experience is called aparoksha. Aparoksha. So, all belief systems, all indirect knowledge is called paroksha. We accept because I believe you are my friend and you have seen Himalayas, I believe you. But I want to experience Himalaya. I want to get a first-hand experience. So belief is a beginning point, but belief is not the end point. Understand? So belief gives us a movement. Oh, there is Himalayas, there's a great Himalaya, somebody said. I believed him. I want to see Himalayas. I want to experience Himalayas. So that's where the movement starts. Okay, that is in terms of objective world. But now the divine or supreme reality is not objective, it is subjective. Okay? From all times, every time, it has been told that God is in your heart. What? It means what? It's my subjective experience.
No, this when you are convinced. Convincing yourself, that turns into belief.
See, for example, let us say, I mean, just take a simple example. Somebody said Himalayas is there, which is great, right? I have not experienced Himalaya. Now, the person who is saying is your friend, whom you trust, you are convinced that Himalaya is there, but it has not become your experience. Okay, so you are assuming what he says is true and Himalaya is a great place. So that extent assumption is there. Now for him Himalaya may be a great place, but if you go there it will be very cold and shivering. Your experience may be very different. Himalaya is not a great place, don't go there, you will get pneumonia. So ultimately what is your test finally? Reality is my inner experience. Everything else is for me is a second-hand information. I might trust it, but that doesn't mean that I'm experiencing it. Right? Somebody says this food is very nice. Okay, fine. And you went and ate it. Not good enough. So there is a difference between a second-hand experience and first-hand experience. Now, why you people are here? There are more, lot of infinite number of second-hand experiences are there. This person saw God, that person saw God in that form, that person saw the reality, that person preached about reality. Yeah, great. Are you happy, satisfied with that? Are you satisfied with what is? I mean, you believe it, of course. All of you believe that, yeah, this is what it is. But are you satisfied with that? Why are you not satisfied with that? Because this is the experience of somebody. It's not sufficient for me. My own inner experience is required. The experience of somebody whom you trust is called paroksha jnana, indirect. But I want to have it directly, it's called aparoksha jnana.
This is belief and confidence. There is two words, belief and confidence. In confidence, there is belief. Without belief, confidence is not. In belief, there is not confidence. So they like.
Sorry, belief, in belief?
Belief and confidence. In confidence, belief also is there. Unless you believe in God, you don't have confidence. In belief, when you are believing in something, there will not be confidence. Only the popular thinking that I believe. They will reflect the popular.
See, when you say confident, you mean trusted.
Trusted.
Yeah. So there is trusted information, there is untrusted information. There are two types of information. But ultimately, both trusted and untrusted is not your experience. It's an indirect input to you. Indirect input is good for you, but because you have to make a journey, start a journey. Unless somebody gives indirect input, you can't make a journey. So belief is a beginning and belief is not the end. Okay? So many, many people make a good beginning. So they become believers. They start as believers and end as believers. They begin as believers. Why you begin as believers? Because I am born in such and such a community, such and such a caste, such and such a society. My great fathers, my great grandfathers, my gurus, my masters, society is telling me, so I believe. They don't take the journey. Of course they take a journey to the extent of believing. So those belief systems are called religion. What is religion all about? A group of believers. So believers have a path because believers have a gap. And that path is yoga. It's a good path to make a journey. Okay? The journey is also in belief. Okay? Destination also is a belief. But some point of time you have to start questioning the belief. Rise above the belief to see the reality. Questioning the belief means questioning the assumptions. Verifying the assumptions. Throwing out the assumptions which are not in tune with the reality. For example, somebody tells me, this is what is reality. For that you have to do 100 steps. And you will get that reality. I believe that person, obviously. And I take that 100 steps. So if I have not reached there, then I'll ask questions, why I have not reached there. Then I'll ask the person, what is this reality all about? The person will say, reality means whatever is there everywhere is called reality. So then why am I taking 100 steps? So now you start questioning the assumptions. Questioning the belief systems. So as long as you are in the belief systems, you are in the religion mode. Now you start questioning the belief systems and you get in the inquiry mode. Because some wrong beliefs and some wrong assumptions are dropped. That's where comes the Sankhya Yoga. See, in general, in spiritual texts, Sankhya Yoga classified as Jnana Yoga because Jnana Yoga and Sankhyanam itself. So now this is not Jnana Yoga in the traditional sense. Jnana Yoga in the traditional sense involves study of scriptures, study of the scripture, contemplation of scripture, meditation, where intellectual action is involved. Sankhya Yoga means a path we are dropping the wrong belief systems. It's a path of neti, 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 drop, 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 until it comes to the point of absolute reality. Yoga involves some amount of steps, achievements. Sankhya Yoga involves dropping all wrong belief systems by questioning assumptions and coming to the reality. It is not a path. Path involves achievement and action. A non-path doesn't involve achievement and action. Non-path involves questioning your position. Where am I standing? Why am I standing here? So that's what is called Atma-Vichara. The shortest and direct path to Atma-Vichara was given by Sri Ramana Maharshi. Whenever somebody goes to Ramana Maharshi, he has only one question. Who are you? He is not giving a path to you. He is not giving the sure way to you. He is not giving a picture of what you read there. What will happen, who are you, find, what will happen, he will not say. He will not give you a belief system. He will not give you knowledge. He is just questioning where, what is your stand, where are you? That's all. A single pointed direct question. So he is asking, who am I? Mean, what belief system is holding you there? So question that, drop wrong belief systems, you are in reality. So that is path called, the shortest and most direct path for reality is Koham, who am I?
He says, go to the source.
Mean, it's just, who am I, find out who am I? Go to the source, doesn't define the source also. Who am I? Find where the thought comes, I thought comes. And Sumanir, be silent. So these are the two steps. So this is actually the path what Ramana Maharshi showed is the path of Vichara or Atma Vichara. It is the most direct path classified as Sankhya Yoga. I told two paths, right? Jnana Yoga, Karma Yogena Yogina, Jnana Yogena Sankhyana. So this is the path of verifying your assumptions, dropping neti neti neti, get to the point where you are. So I am telling this clarification because the moment people put Jnana Yoga in a Sankhyana, they start putting a lot of study of scriptures in the Jnana Yoga. Study, contemplation. They are all coming in the Karma Yoga. It's intellectual action. This Jnana Yoga is very different. This Jnana Yoga is dropping. Whereas Karma Yoga involves gaining. Ultimately the purpose of Karma Yoga is to Chitta Shuddhi, purification. They are all required. Okay? I am not saying that's not required. It's helping you to purify your consciousness, subconscious impressions, and acquire some of the qualities which are required for self-realization called Shama, Dama, Titiksha, Uparati, Shraddha, Samadhana, Mumukshatva. They are called Shat Sampatis. Some calmness of the mind is required. Okay. So a person who has reached that becomes a mature person. Such a person is called Sankhya Yogi. Sankhya. So this Atma-Vichara talks is series is more about the self-inquiry, looking at our assumptions. Okay? There's no jnana, new jnana, but just giving, looking at a point of various assumptions. And how do you look at the assumptions? Is there a reference required? Yes, the reference comes from Vedanta. Okay? I can imagine some of these things and question, start questioning. So tomorrow, yeah, I want to do self-inquiry, I'll sit and ask, who am I, what will come? who am I? Nothing will come out because you need a reference. So the person who has come to Sankhya Yoga already has a reference. He has already got the background to do self-inquiry. Okay? So now he has become mature because he has already got the foundation. So the person, that's why Sri Ramana Maharshi says, for person who is mature, this much questioning is sufficient. So we are looking at some of the assumptions or foundations on which we can build self-inquiry. Okay. So this is the first talk on that. Is that background clear enough? Any questions?
Studying of scriptures, it also makes us to remove some of the rasa.
Yeah.
So
it comes.
This
overlap. So study of scriptures, lot of wrong assumptions, and probably in study of scriptures itself somebody realizes also. That's fine. So I'm saying a person has come to a certain level of maturity. Now he starts. The problem is not acquiring more knowledge. Right? Many people keep on going after scripture in the process of acquiring knowledge. So now this person has understood. It's not acquiring knowledge, dropping wrong assumptions. So he has already moved into Sankirtan. Okay. So that's why there are seekers are of four types according to Sri Krishna. Artho jidnasu arthati jnani cha bardashava. Artha jidnasu arthati jnani. So most of the people begin on a spiritual journey because there are difficulties. This problem is there, that problem is there. The life has a lot of challenges. So because of the challenges, they start looking for some help, some helping hand from the divine or the higher power. They are called arthas. Artha means those who are in difficulty. So now they don't have wisdom of what is Atma, what is Self, what is God, what is Supreme Reality, but they have a belief that something can help me. So for example, Draupadi comes in this category. She was in trouble. She was being disrobed. Initially, she started making her own attempt to protect herself. She did everything to protect herself. Nothing worked out. Finally, a point came, she came to a situation where helplessness, then she lifted both hands and called out, Krishna, I'm in trouble. Now nothing I can do. I have come to a stage of total helplessness. That's called Artha. So then comes the Jignasu. Jignasu means somebody wants to understand reality. Why he understands the reality? Because he is curious. He wants to know. The scientist comes under this category. What is reality? Let me understand. Okay. What is reality? What is behind material nature? Let me understand. This is more of a curiosity. So why he is curious? Maybe because by understanding that he'll feel happy. Maybe because understanding that he can write some papers in the international journals. Maybe he can get Nobel Prize. Maybe he can get salary and money. That person is called Jitnasu. Then somebody is there, Arthati, I want money, position, power. Okay. So I want more help from the divine hand. So Arthati. Then finally one person comes, is called Jnani. Jnani means one who understands the reality, the supreme reality as his own self. The reality is my self. The reality is not outside, not inside. It is myself which transcends outside and inside. When I say self, it's not individual self. It's not personalized self. The self in capital letters or Brahman or Ishvara, who transcends the individual. he is establishing that Shri Krishna says he is me. That means he has become one with me. Now you see this journey, artha jitnasu arthati. Okay, each of them have a goal and desire seeking. Whereas Dani has reached the destination, his own self. So these three categories of people, artho, jidnasu, arthati, we call as seekers. Dani is not a seeker, he is already there. Right? So why do I seek? Who is a seeker is the question for the day. So I already of course told three categories: artha, difficulty, curiosity, and some money, power, position, arthati. Now, who is a seeker and why this seeking is there? So normally we classify people under two categories: materialist and spiritualist. Hey, this person is materialist. He has wanted money, power, and position. He is a materialist. I am a spiritualist. Is there something called materialist and spiritualist in life? Because typically, we tend to look life in either or, this or that. Is there something called materialism and spiritualism? Is there a seeker called spiritual seeker, or is there a seeker called material seeker? What's your opinion?
There are different steps between spiritualist and materialist. Everyone cannot be led by either of the two extremes.
So, there's a gradation.
Gradation.
Actually, what is that people are seeking? What is that seeking?
Happiness.
People are seeking happiness. Animals, the birds, human beings. Who is not seeking happiness? And why do you seek happiness? My nature, I want to be. By my seeking happiness, if I get happy, I'll be peaceful. Otherwise, I'm disturbed, agitated. So the happiness and peace is what everybody is seeking. Not only you, not only human beings, animals also. See the happiness in the dog's face when he sees a loaf of bread, biscuit. Every living being and possibly non-living being, are looking for happiness and peace. Right? Then what are you seeking? Are you seeking God? Are you seeking self?
The other meaning is incompleteness.
Incompleteness. So, somewhere I feel incompleteness, I seek happiness and peace. It is not only me, everybody. So in that context, there is no material seeker or spiritual seeker. Everybody is a seeker. Seeking, seeking, seeking. What? Happiness and peace.
It's already there.
If already there is a jnani, is not a seeker. So already there is a knowledge, or already there is an experience, or already there is a realization. If it's already there is a realization, he comes out of the category of fourth category, jnani. So he is no more seeking. Right? So already there is an assumption or reality for you? No. See, this is what I'm saying. We start living in our belief as reality. So peace is already there, is a belief. Somebody told, some scriptures told, yes. But is it my reality? Huh? Is it by reality? So that makes the difference between yogi and jnani. So it's not assumption. It is my reality. So then, artho jitnasu arthati, you are moved into jnani kade. Then he is no longer seeking. So, until that point of seeking doesn't stop. So the question is, what is this seeking all about? Its happiness and peace. Right? And I call myself a seeker. Now, who is a seeker? Let us understand the self or the individual who is seeking. We need to understand who is seeking. Right? So now we are questioning, who is that seeking? I am not speaking of the category of people, artho, jitnasu, arthati. Who is that me who is seeking? Who in me is seeking? How you can seek yourself? So, who is me seeking is the question now. For that you have to understand who is me. Without understanding me, I cannot understand who is in me seeking. So, I have I have me consists of a feeling, an emotion, a thinking. I'm not looking at the body, mind, and intellect. The me consists of feeling, emotions, and thinking. Okay? Feeling, emotions, thinking is what I call a so-called me. Of course, the body, mind, I'm speaking of the experience wise. The feeling is experience. Okay?
Difference between feeling and
we'll come to it. Emotions and thinking. These are three. So in this, who is seeking? Is feeling seeking? Is emotion seeking? Or is thinking seeking?
Self is seeking. Self is seeking.
No, these are the self.
Is seeking all these things.
No. Self is has three aspects. The feeling.
No. What I mean to say is self is seeking all these things.
Self itself is doing that. Now who is that self is we are trying to understand. Right? So let us understand feeling first. What do you mean by feeling? The feeling is the sense experience of the world. We have five senses. The eyes, tongue, nose, ears, and sensations. Which is the largest sense organs in our body?
Skin.
The skin is the largest sense organ in the body. So, with this, we are feeling the environment. The feeling the environment comes from these five. This feeling separates me from the environment. Feeling marks a boundary between me and the environment. Right? The feeling is the boundary. The feeling was the most primitive instinct for a living being in the evolution scale. The most primitive. How is that most primitive? Imagine the last smallest one-celled organism, let's say bacteria, amoeba, one cell, single cell. There's no male and female there. Just a single-celled organism. Now the single-celled organism has no nervous system. It just feels the environment. If the heat is there, it will run away. It will die. If the food is there, it will go towards that. So the basic primitive level, only two instincts are there. What is that? Rejection and acceptance. This we call as raga and dvesha in Sanskrit. Attraction and repulsion. These are the two basic primitive instincts by nature. There's nothing else, no processing. I like this, I don't like this. Now this raga and dvesha is the basic primitive instinct, is fully alive in our body because our largest organ, largest sense organ is skin, which is made up of billions of cells, and each of them has a raga and dvesha, each of them has attraction and repulsion. Right? So the raga and dvesha has come as a survival instinct. When I say instinct, it means no intelligence involved. It's a programmed action. The nature has programmed that. So you don't have choice. Like when you program your computer, computer doesn't have a choice. Of course, artificial intelligence has a choice, but normal computer programs don't have a choice. A car has no choice. Like that, instinct means a programmed behavior which has gone into cellular level. And largest sense organ for us is the body, which body and muscles and all, which are nothing but full of everybody is exercising raga and dvesha. It's like a voting system. So when say spiritual system says raga and dvesha has to be left, they're not speaking about the intellectual level, they're left at the physical level. You have to overcome raga and dvesha. That's what is called titiksha, ability to withstand pain and pleasure. The whole basic mechanism of functioning is based on raga and dvesha. Raga and dvesha is the nature's way of driving you. Nature has programmed every living being. Raga and dvesha is your way of life. So now look at the cellular organism. It's only raga and dvesha. And there is this cellular organism, to survive, its chance of better survival, it'll get together all guys with the raga, same raga. It'll make a group, a colony of cells. So now, instead of one person, one cell surviving, now 100 survive. Their strength, what is their sangatana, their strength in the groupism. So they start becoming a group. And what is the group? All of them have common raga and common desha, like-minded. There's no mind. Mind is at the basic primitive level, it's working as a raga and desha. Okay? Understood? So now, these cellular group, they want a communication mechanism. They have internet and telephone connection is required. Otherwise, how do they communicate? So many people are joining together. And some of the cells, they start becoming a communication agents because they don't have anything to borrow. They themselves modify themselves into a nervous system, a communication channel. And what is the communication channel now? What is the communication which is required? Raga and dvesha, okay, has to be converted into fight or flight. Together we'll fight or together we'll run away. Basic principle is what? Raga and dvesha. And now collective action is coming. Individual level, raga and dvesha. The collectively, let us fight or flight. So the nervous system came into picture. And where is the nervous system? The spinal part. Okay? And that's where first reptilians evolved. Fight or flight. So their basic instincts of raga and dvesha now became three primitive instincts. Nidra, Bhaya, Maituna. Maituna means sex. So we want to grow because we can become stronger quality. Food means raga, I want. Nidra means rest, there's no problem. So now this became the basic, the spinal cord became the basic communication channel. And the cells, the organism started behaving, grouping around that. So this is actually called what you call a reptilian brain, what we have, spinal cord. And reptilian brain is only automatic response. There's no processing, no thinking. Feeling is there, immediately responsive. Right? So gradually, such organs, such more organs have came into picture now. You are not the smart, no? Everybody else is also smart. They also started grouping around the spinal cord and nervous system. So now how do I relate to that fellow? Another organism. So I have to decide for between that organism. He is my friendly or enemy. Right? You understand? First primitive instinct of raga and desha got translated into fight or flight, which translated into three actions: ahara, nidra, maituna, sex. So now I maituna, why it came in picture? Now I started having a male and female. Till that time male and female were not there, because we have to reproduce and increase our community. So some of the cells took form of female and male, that came into picture. So gradually, now to relate to others, we had to bring a higher order system, and that is called our emotional brain. Okay. So the emotional brain is midbrain. So here now, the raga and dvesha, which got into fight and flight, became emotions. What are the emotions? The fear, the anger, the stress, the love, okay, the compassion. So this got converted into emotions. The fight or flight, okay, which is called dvesha, got converted into negative emotions. What are they? The fear, the anger, the jealousy, the hatred. And raga, attraction, got converted into the love, compassion. This increases our survival chances. So this became a midbrain processing. Now please understand, the feeling and emotion processing is moment to moment. There's no thinking of next moment. At this moment something has to happen, it will happen. Okay? So is feeling or emotion a part of the seeker? The feeling and emotion is in this moment. The seeking is in the future. I have to get something. Right? At this moment, what is the seeking? Survival. There's nothing. The feeling and emotion are the basic instincts which has grown into an emotional level. Right? So now, what happened to the emotion? The fight or flight has to be converted into bodily action. The whole organism needs to move. So for example, a deer is there in the forest. A tiger comes. The feeling has given the input. Immediately the emotion has to rise. Emotion of fear. The emotion of fear has to rise and action has to be taken. Immediately signal will be sent to the heart, kidney, okay, pump more blood, run. Right? So the fear gets started into in us, gets started into heartbeat, the pulse, palpitation. So because action has to be taken. Right? The fear has got converted to emotion. Are we clear so far? So that's the end of it? No. So now individual cells became a colony, and colony became an organism. Organism started building colony of organisms. Because emotions came into picture. Now you can relate to other. Is that the end of it? So now, moment to moment living is not sufficient for me. I have to address my tomorrow. What will I do? I need thinking. Now thinking started. See how from bottom up we are going up. Raga and desha became fight and flight, and which became emotions of love, hatred and reaction. And emotions and feeling levels always in this moment. It's not in the future. Now thinking came into picture. What is this thinking all about? Thinking is present moment experience. Let me take it, keep it in memory, and what I have to do tomorrow, I'll plan. Thinking is all about the future by using the past. Project the future. And imagination ability came into picture. Because to project the future, you need imagination. So basically feeling, primitive instinct, it became emotion, which is primitive instinct, and it became thinking, which is the upper brain or rational brain. So we have what you call spinal cord, reptilian brain, midbrain called emotional brain, and rational brain. So now I am able to think. What do you think? The deer goes to the forest, a tiger pounces on it, the fear rises, it jumps, goes. Heartbeat increases, it goes. So now it recorded, memory. What is recorded? Tiger stays here, so I should not go on this way. The memory is recorded that. Then also response is recorded. What should I do in the tiger? The fear should come, I should jump and run. So tomorrow the deer goes there. Tomorrow says, no, the memory says, no, don't go there, tiger is there. Okay, the deer takes another route, right? So thinking helped to develop the strategy for survival for the future. Now animals became much more stronger and bigger animals called human beings. And they have more powerful imagination engine, more powerful thinking engine. They started misusing it. What? They not only understood the tiger sitting there, they start, okay, how do I kill the tiger? Okay? No. If the tiger is sitting there, what happens if my child goes there? You create all imaginary situations, it doesn't exist. Now every time you create an imaginary situation, your feeling and emotion respond because there's a sequence it is killed. So now imagination becomes hallucination. It started producing unnecessary thoughts. Okay? So thinking up to the feeling and emotion level, this only present today. Thinking level, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, and yesterday came into picture. So with the thinking, human beings organized as caste, community, religion, country, they became a bigger colonies because they want to survive as a stronger unit. And now they wanted a powerful nervous system. That's where they developed the mobile phone, internet, the communication. Now nervous system, which was in the primitive nervous system, spinal cord, became a nervous system of the world. So we have grown as a colony. But please understand, basically you are a colony of cells driven by raga and desha. And it's organizing as a bigger entity and bigger strategies. So that's why all spiritual teaching says, you come out of raga and desha. Oh, how do I come out of raga and desha? The raga and desha is embedded in every cell of your body. The primitive instinct. Okay? Every cell of your body is vibrating with raga and desha. No, develop love. That's the emotional brain. That's next level of instinct. The love, my chances of survival are better. No? If I hate you, you will kick me because you are powerful. At least let me start developing love for you. So our chance of survival becomes better. Like that emotional thinking game. Now rational thinking game, it started with lot of strategies how to survive. Then rational thinking brain started, I have to survive. So animal has no concept of tomorrow or yesterday. Feeling in emotional level, there's no yesterday and tomorrow. It's now. The thinking came into picture. I have to survive. Then the question comes, why you have to survive? Yeah, I have survived in past memory. How long did you survive? You were born in 6 months back, 1 year back, or 10 years back. No, my life extends beyond 10 years. I have been many lifetimes. So now your thinking started creating past lifetimes also. Then he says, I have to survive. The feeling and emotion says, survive now. The thinking says, I have to survive in this lifetime, I have to survive in many lifetimes, next lifetime. So who is the seeker? Who is seeking now? Who is seeking here? The future lifetimes I want to get out. Or future lifetime, one day I will get into this situation is messy. One day I'll get into heaven. This is what your imagination and thinking capability has given to you.